You live from Super Tuesday 2020.
Listening to the weekend, watching results here tonight. You gotta wait for this drum. This song's fire.
Yeah, we were saying the weekend era. Basically, all the hip-hop, all the pop music, very little doesn't sound like this to some degree. Cannot be like traced back, like the textures and the aesthetics of it. Like the Billie Eilish.
Yeah.
Totally, Billie Eilish, like that. Like, and all like the...
Dude, I honestly just did what I said I do when I don't know an artist, where I just agree.
Oh, you just did.
I just did that. I know Billie Eilish is big right now. I haven't listened to her whatsoever.
Yeah,
I've only done a little bit. I haven't done a proper deep dive, so I'm not an expert. But, you know, she has like this kind of like gloomy, dark aesthetic.
Is that true?
I think that's fair.
I have no idea.
I think it's fair. I think people have also linked her to Lana Del Rey.
Okay.
Which
she has a big place in your heart.
Yeah, very close to my heart. I could do multiple. I could do an extended podcast. I could have a dedicated Lana podcast, really.
Yeah.
Because I delve into song by song, but.
Side project.
Yeah.
No, we are two reluctant cogs. We have to start with the name.
Two reluctant cogs checking in.
Yeah, what's the date? Should we start with that
today? Yeah, what is the date today? It's Super Tuesday.
March 3rd. Tuesday, March 3rd. Super Tuesday.
2020. For all those future deep divers.
All the future fans living in a socialist utopia, we are here live.
The
moment it started. The revolution started today.
Yeah.
When these California results come in, and in all likelihood, our American Lenin will thankfully bring us into the 20th century, finally. Yep. Finally,
21st century socialism.
20th century, yeah. That's where we're going with Bernie.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's like, I don't know that he's really updated to the 21st
century. Yeah, we were saying, like, when he read a Noam Chomsky book when he was, like, in his 20s, and he was like, this is great.
I'm gonna
become a politician, and hasn't read anything else since then.
No, has not been updated whatsoever.
Which, like, Noam Chomsky, he's a good writer. Good speaker.
Yeah, my mom actually bought me like 20 Noam Chomsky books because I watched an interview with him when I was like 20.
Yeah.
And I was like, this guy gets it.
Yeah.
I'm trying to learn everything he's done. I never read one of those books. I read like 3 pages of one. I was like, this seems hard.
Yeah. And well, you saved yourself from Bernie's fate.
Yeah. I got the highlights.
Yeah.
Now I have a Chomskyite.
Yeah.
Running for, in all likelihood, he's a Democratic frontrunner.
Well, that's Trevor Stake. You know, we'll see. He definitely is the frontrunner. Coming into Super Tuesday for sure.
Yeah.
And the question is, does he come out of Super Tuesday, you know, just cemented that, or is it all of a sudden become a neck and neck race?
And see, this is a classic podcast problem right now, because by the time people listen to this, the results will be known.
Yeah.
So we have to keep that in mind.
Yeah. So let's not focus on those kind of minutiae and talk about the meta-narratives.
Yeah, the meta-narratives. I mean, either way, so he's either, I mean, I guess just to catch up on where we were, a lot has happened in the Democratic primary, so... We had a couple fiery debates.
We
talked about Bloomberg getting torpedoed, right?
Oh, the first one, yeah. And then he came back in the second one and had the most bizarre comment. He goes, I'm surprised any of the other contestants, if you can call them that, even showed up to this debate given how well I did last time. And then smile at the camera. Like, nobody laughed.
No one laughed.
Like, what? Everybody was like, what? What?
It was pretty painful. It was a pretty painful...
One of the most bizarre things I've ever witnessed.
I think he was trying to own the fact that he got destroyed.
And like kind of like ha-ha, but I'm back.
The worst debate performance of all time.
Yeah, it was just so bizarre.
I think he was just trying to own it and like get ahead of it, but like did not craft the joke.
And also it was so out of place. They were like arguing about all sorts of other things, and then he like interrupted to say that.
Yeah, he interrupted to say that joke. And while we're on that actual debate, Pete Buttigieg talking over people in that debate was a real problem.
Yeah.
It was a like
total meme.
It, just like how, but in the previous one, he and Klobuchar sparring
yeah.
made Pete look bad.
Yeah.
I thought in this one
he cemented his status as a pretentious, arrogant, like little punk.
Yeah.
Like, you know, young punk. Yeah. Even though he's older than me, but like young, he just like gives off that vibe of like, you know, like that teenager who's yelling at you, you don't know about, and you're like, grow up, like go get a job, like come talk to me after you've paid taxes or
can
something.
I finish my sentence and then maybe you argue with what I'm saying. Yeah. And just try to shout me down.
Yeah.
And the thing, and the worst part about the Buttigieg doing that in the debate, like, you know, is he didn't have any zingers. It's like
he gets the mic. Let's see the zinger.
Yeah. And it's like, we want a campaign where people aren't having a heart attack when they check their Twitter.
Yeah.
And yeah, everyone's just like what you needed to say right now.
The most like generic, the most generic, like vanilla, like Google search inspirational campaign rhetoric and like and then regurgitated it when everything was focused on him. He like just stolen the camera, stolen the moment.
Multiple times it's either that or it's like, you know, what people need to remember is we need to beat Donald Trump. And it's like, thanks, Pete. We're all on the same page at the Democratic primary. You don't need to ground us in this baseline truth that we're going to run it eventually against Donald Trump in the general election.
Yeah, as if anybody doesn't realize that,
yeah, like there's anyone else on this. Tom Steyer's like, oh, is that what we're doing here?
Yeah, Tom Steyer's like, well, yeah.
Yeah, I had no idea.
So, Tom Steyer also out.
Yeah, so that's the thing. Pete's out.
He's gone. I'm not. It's so interesting. Like,
this is the last time we'll talk about him.
Yeah, right? It's so interesting. Yeah, well, until he gets, unless Biden wins,
until
and
next cycle.
Unless Biden wins and nominates him as a cabinet secretary down the road, you know, I could see that.
What would you nominate him for?
Well, that's you have to imagine that's the trade, because he dropped out, and he immediately was seen on the campaign trail with Biden in Texas.
Hilarious. What do you see him as most qualified to do within the executive?
I think he'd like secretary of like. I mean, he's got his ego, so he can't take a minor secretary.
Yeah,
it has
he's
to be
not
like
looking for an interior job.
Yeah, no. Or health and human services. No.
Probably HUD. He really connects to like urban voters. You know? I think he'd be great as like, you know, housing and urban development.
Recall that he back in his city in.
Diversity in South Bend. Yeah, that's the... Oh, my God.
Yeah, like, okay. So, well, thank God we're done with the Pete phase.
We're done with the Pete phase. We're also
though
done.
It is so funny how we can be so convinced of it as a possibility. Like, the narratives get so... are so, like, gripping when you're in them that, like, just, like, you know, pre-Iowa, let's say Iowa, it's all of a sudden, like, Pete's a legitimate shot.
I'll say it.
I thought he had a legitimate shot.
I promise, you know that you get me on points all the time, and I can see and I say I was wrong about shit. And I like to think I can admit when I'm wrong, and I don't like to always be like, I knew this was going to happen, or be like that type of person. I never for a second believed in Pete.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen this in every primary, as have you, and I think people forget that primaries are all about these people cresting and then falling back to earth. I remember the Republican primary where Newt Gingrich went on TV and said, literally said in an interview on like 60 Minutes, he's like, well, I mean, if you're looking at the polls, in all likelihood, I'm going to be the next president of the United States. That's what Newt Gingrich said. Like, within 3 weeks, he was gone.
Yeah.
I think I maybe even said that last week.
Yeah.
Like, this shit happens in every primary, and Pete was no different. He never had
a path. Which
Klobuchar
I totally.
Never really had a path.
Yeah, and Klobuchar never really had
a
path.
At the end of the day, it was always Biden v. Bernie.
I was really convinced that he had a path, and you know, I guess I just was completely.
I think you were buying the Beltway hype a little bit.
Buying the Beltway hype, and also just like getting so glued in on the Iowa, New Hampshire results because he led big there.
I mean, and how funny is that? Is that and like, then this dude won Iowa and then immediately dropped out because it just
and sec big finish in New Hampshire too.
Big finish, I guess. Yeah, but it just goes to show you that like not everyone can do the Obama path. Right?
Yeah.
Like
and those states, you know, we give them a lot of shit for having that first place position.
Yeah,
and like turns out
they're not good bellwethers for it. I mean, and 538 like, weights their election statistics based on who wins Iowa, which I think is hilarious because if you remember 2016, when 538 along with everyone else was calling like Hillary 99% and Ted Cruz won in Iowa.
Yeah,
you know, it's like maybe you guys should adjust your models. Maybe Iowa's not a great predictor.
Yeah,
because the last previous two elections. Iowa hasn't meant shit.
And Joe, and we were shitting on Joe. We both were shitting on Joe. I know I was shitting on Joe in Iowa and New Hampshire, being like, he's going to drop out. And then he turns around and comes second place in Nevada and first place, a resounding first place in South Carolina.
And now
here we are. And like, I mean, he's already won Virginia.
That's one of the results from tonight we see. North Carolina, I think, has been called for him.
Let's see what else we've got up.
I think he's expected to do well in the South. I'll go ahead and stake my position right now, not knowing how this is going to turn out.
Yeah.
I do think Bernie's going to just stomp him out right now. Tonight, Bernie's going to stomp him out.
So, I think...
What it means is not like that Joe is statistically going to be eliminated tonight,
but
that Bernie will have so many delegates, have so much momentum,
and
he already has the grassroots organization in a way that Biden, frankly, doesn't.
Yeah.
Biden is not a populist. Biden hasn't even been campaigning in these states. And now he's got all the momentum from, like, the money and the establishment.
And the other people, other moderates dropping out.
Yeah, exactly. Klobuchar that should boost him, but I don't think he has... You really do have to have, like, in this day and age, populist support, I believe. And he doesn't have that. Trump has that. Bernie has that.
Yeah.
I thought Bloomberg might have been able to generate it, but he just fell, like, he stepped on a rake.
Yeah.
I don't know. The debates, literally wiped him out.
Yeah, he was a disaster. And I think he'll, it's a kind of a shame because the amount of money he spent, Jesus.
Can you imagine if you were so bad at debating that within 4 hours of you talking in front of a camera, you've effectively neutralized the, whatever $1 billion that you spent in your favor and buying credibility.
Yeah.
You just wiped that out with 2 hours of conversation.
Not even Trump can do that.
Trump does everything in his power to
put his foot in his mouth.
Put his foot in his mouth. Literally every time he talks. Biden too.
Yeah.
Biden too. Biden can't put a sentence together, yet somehow Bloomberg can just put words in an order in such a way that
And also just give off the vibe
vibe.
The vibe of just, oh my God. Yeah.
Brutal. So anyway, so that's super Tuesday.
I'm a little skeptical of the Bernie stomp.
What do you think's
narrative?
Gonna happen?
I feel like Bernie's gonna come out of this in the lead. He's gonna win California, so that's a big chunk of delegates. But I feel like Biden's gonna be above that 15% threshold in every state. And wherever Bernie does win, it's not going to be like, big marginal hauls relative to Biden. So Bernie's going to come out definitely in the lead, definitely still the front runner, but like we're going to go into the next series of primaries with this thing still open.
Right.
And I think what you're going to see is both Warren and Bloomberg will drop out officially, so it'll really become the Biden versus Bernie thing, and it's like, there's a lot of delegates still out there, and like it'll become like a pretty tight race.
So just to summarize, then, where you think the country is going, irrespective of who's right about Super Tuesday, it is looking like, no matter which way you slice it, the next president of the United States is either going to be Joe Biden, Donald Trump, or Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
March 2020. This is what we're looking at, U.S. This is the
congratulations.
From the Democratic, Party of Diversity, Big Tent, like open and inclusive party. We got two old white East Coast males, and from the Republican,
not just old. I mean, very old.
And in Biden's case, senile. Absolutely senile.
That's why the vice president. The vice president pick for Biden is going to be, if he wins the nomination, is huge, because very good chance he's in a wheelchair halfway through the presidency.
There's
a good chance he doesn't finish it, and let alone go in a second term.
A second term is just a fucking...
So the vice president is just going to be a critical pick if he wins the nomination.
Can you imagine, anyone who has watched Biden speak, at any event, it's the man cannot put together a sentence in a coherent way. He talks as if he's struggling to know where he is.
Yeah, well, that's what it's different than the Trump. Because Trump can't put together a sentence, but it's very much like...
It's because he's like too angry.
Yeah, and he's like, and he's like riffing.
His vocabulary is too small.
But he's still all... He's
like all over the place, and he's just like regurgitating headlines that he thought were good.
It's more of a reflection of his basic underlying intellect, whereas Biden, you can see that like he once knew these words
and
once was able to pull together, and you can see him squinting and like really trying to get the words out, and it's like it's really like you've seen it on your grandparents' face before. It's like,
I've had this conversation a number of times, and so I may be repeating myself from the last podcast as well, but I'm just gonna reiterate if that's the case, and if not, here's some just something that astounded me was Biden recalling the time where he was imprisoned for protesting apartheid in South Africa. And I saw a headline that said Biden campaign official confirms that Biden was never arrested in South Africa for protesting apartheid. It's like, what other major candidate could get away with saying, like, yeah, who knows? Maybe I was in Delaware. Maybe I was in South Africa protesting apartheid.
Not even Trump lies like that. Trump will just be like, oh, these people are taking your jobs. Like, those kind of lies or, like, whatever. Yeah. I don't even think Trump would try to pull something like that. Like,
no. This is like Trump being like, yeah, I was at the High Have a Dream speech.
Yeah.
That's essentially what Biden's doing.
Yeah.
And it's like, as if we can't fact-check this in 2020. It immediately gets fact-checked, and it gets fact-checked so effectively that it's not even a story, because it's like, ah, you know, Joe, he just says shit.
Yeah.
We just take it for granted now. He just says shit that's just, like, proven wrong all the time about his...
And it's not just us. I was walking to lunch today on, you know, New York City sidewalk, so overheard on New York City, I heard someone just shitting on Biden, these two construction workers. I think they probably were still going to vote for him, but they were like... My wheelchair joke I stole from them. I heard them saying, as I walked by... He'll be in a wheelchair 2 years in. He'll be pushing him in a wheelchair 2 years in.
And the funny thing is, like, he's the same age as Trump and Bernie.
Yeah.
They're all, like, they're all, like, within 2 years of each other. And so while they, you know, Trump, I think, is showing signs, even during his 4 years in office, I think he's...
Which is, I mean, that's, it happens to everybody.
It happens to everyone.
Yeah. And it's just that when you start at 70 plus, it's
There's
tougher.
A big difference between your physical and mental, like, health.
I mean,
at 74 and 78.
Yeah, and I mean, Obama was what, in his 40s when he was elected.
Yeah,
like prime, primo health.
Yeah, and so now we're picking a geriatric. And just think about it. I want everyone who does listen to this, just think about your job. Think about the work you've done in your lifetime and how hard you've worked at some places and how stressed you get about work. And then stacking that together day after day, year after year, maybe you put in like 2-3 decades at a company, right? How worn down by work you are, and like how much every single year you just can't wait to retirement. Now imagine saying the normal retirement age is what, 65? That's like supposed to be the retirement age. I don't think that's true anymore, but it's supposed to be 65. Imagine 10 years after that retirement age being like, you know what I'm ready for? The most physically and intellectually, spiritually, and emotionally taxing job available on the market.
Yeah.
That's what I want to do from age 74 to 78.
Yeah.
And not only do I want to do it, I think I'm the best person.
In the whole world.
In the whole world. For the most stressful, intense, mentally and physically tough position on the planet. It's just unfathomable to me that, like, we don't take that into account.
I think it's definitely normal. Everybody wants to take that into account, but somehow the way the process works, like somehow the way the great filtering of like the political process has just spit out these old people. Like, I think everybody knows Biden's old and Bernie's old and nobody likes it, but they're all like, all the Bernie people are like, well, we would never vote for Biden, so we can only trust Bernie with this.
Yeah.
And likewise, all the Biden people now are basically saying, we liked so-and-so, we liked other people, but, like, Biden's the only one that can unite the party against Bernie.
Yeah, no, I know. I know, but it's like... The fact that the selection...
It's like this, like, the meta process of, like, how did we end up here?
Yeah.
Like, 20 months ago, when people started making noises about 2020, like, when the first Democratic wheel started going, we had all these candidates available. How did we end up here?
Let me just say this. Like, if you were starting a company, if you were doing a startup, or even if you're, like, a very mature, like, titan in the corporate space, like, you're Facebook, and Facebook announced, hey, we're going to drop Zuckerberg. Is Zuckerberg the CEO?
He's
the founder.
Yeah.
He's, like,
everything.
He's
the CEO.
He's the king. So we're going to actually, you know, Zuckerberg's going to retire, and we're going to bring in this 80-year-old to run Facebook. He's going to provide the vision for this organization. What do you think the stock price would do?
Yeah.
What do you think our company that we work for, like, you know, would have, if our CEO just stepped down and we just hired an 80-year-old who's like, yeah, I want to get behind, you know, I want to be on top of, like,
tech.
You know, tech.
The green revolution.
The green revolution, the energy sector. You know, it's like I want to learn about, you know, machine learning and demand response and integrated.
It's like, dude, you've got a few brain cells left. You're not gonna learn. It's like you can't.
It's like that dude learned how to type on a typewriter.
Yeah. And yeah. Like, what, or before that.
Or
yeah.
Before that. Yeah. I mean, cursive was a really important thing to learn when he was in school. He or she was in school. Like, that's the age difference we're talking about. And so now we're not talking about running a company. We're talking about running the most. A $5 trillion company.
Also, in arguably the most dire straits it's been in decades.
Oh, yeah. In decades. What, are you talking about the existential threats from climate change, coronavirus,
yeah.
The economy crashing, you know,
it's
maintaining nuclear deterrence, that's something we don't even talk about anymore because we got other problems in front of our face. Anyway, it is, so that's the primary.
It's the primary, and
we're
here we are.
We're really excited about the election.
Yeah, we are. We've got a. Yeah, we are. I think we are excited. We're excited for the content. I think
I'm excited for the content. I mean, either
it's gonna
way,
do
it's wonder. Crazy.
It's gonna do wonders for the ratings of the podcast's ratings.
Yeah,
for
I'm
sure.
Expecting subscribers to double. You know, over the next few years.
Yeah,
simply
for sure.
From an increase in the amount of political content that's going to be available, people need to digest it.
I mean, we've always said it, and I'll stand by it. Bernie versus Trump debates would be great content. Biden versus Trump debates are much less interesting.
A Biden versus Trump debate, to be honest,
it's painful to watch.
It's gonna be like, it's like watching Mike Tyson come in and like do like box a high schooler.
No, it's not gonna be that bad. Do you think so?
Biden can't talk.
Yeah.
And when you're talking with Trump in a debate, do you remember how vicious he was? Yeah, yeah. Interrupting her the whole time, just like no. Wrong,
yeah.
wrong, lies. He's just going to be doing that shit to just throw you off your game. It's already hard enough for him to talk, let alone with that running monologue happening on the microphone next to him. Like, he's a liar. Ask him about his son in Ukraine and Burisma. He's the most corrupt politician who's ever been. I think even Minnie would be better.
Yeah.
Like, this is like, he would get absolutely shredded.
Yeah.
And there's nothing he could do. Yeah, he can't just be like, but I was with Obama.
Yeah.
That's not going to fly in a general election debate.
Yeah.
You're trying to win over half the country from rabid Trump supporters, and you put this, like, I don't know, man. I think that would be like, I mean, I would watch it for sure. There'd be
You have to
watch it, but like,
it would be it'd be sad almost.
You'd have to have like in Little League, you know, when like team goes up by like 15 runs.
Yeah.
Like if Trump just like beats him too badly, they gotta just end the debate after like 30 minutes.
Go to commercial break. Yeah.
Yeah, and just be like, no, we're good. Yeah. Trump won this one. We're just calling it.
Yeah.
We're not gonna do the full 2 hours tonight. Like Biden needs to just fucking recharge. You gotta plug in.
Yeah. So it could be bad. Yeah, I think the Bernie versus Trump ones will be more interesting.
Yeah, I mean,
there's still going to be chaos. The content.
Chaos, yeah.
But it'll
at least
be
Bernie can like chip. Like Bernie can like actually hear what Trump says.
Yeah, Bernie's been great in the debates so far. He's probably been the most consistently strong debater on the stage.
You know what? I heard someone, I think it was on that Libertarian podcast I was listening to recently. They were talking about Bernie and this quality he has in the debate that I think would not do well in the general election. And it's the fact that if you like press him on something that you could say is like superficial or not.
Yeah, but
press him on something like Cuba or like press him on like his socialism stuff and be like, time to communism. You know, even if it's a superficial attack
thing,
or whatever,
it's like,
the way he responds to it is like kind of nasty.
Yeah, it's like, you know, indignation.
He gets like in a really angry place and is like, what, you know, how much did you pay in taxes? Remember he like said that to one of the moderators?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just like, so, and I agree, like you do see his nasty streak come out.
And his like, how dare you question me? Like kind of.
Yeah, it's not like, you know, he's coming at this like, we're starting a revolution for labor and for the working class and for the poor, and like he's trying to be inspirational and like, you know, this guy ain't Martin Luther King. You know, like he's not approaching like these issues from a place of like love and generosity of spirit.
Yeah.
He's coming from a place of like
power.
I know what's right. And anyone who thinks that I'm wrong is immoral and like beneath talking to.
Yeah.
Right? He comes at it from like this kind of condescending place.
Yeah, it's very much like we have the high ground. It's like we're fighting for the power and we're going to take the power. And it's
right
us against them.
So.
It's
right
it's us against them. With us or against us. And that's, I mean, people have said that to all through the primary, and he's kind of shrugged it off. But there's a truth to it, and it's in his style.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, whatever. It doesn't
I think it helps when you're like, I mean, to be honest, Donald Trump is the same thing, right?
Yeah.
Like Donald Trump is.
Well, and it's
just
very much.
Like people respond to that.
No. Yeah. They're not. There's no.
the word I'm thinking for here. They're not, taking names, and it's like, they're just not asking for forgiveness. They're like very like proud of their position.
Proud of their position.
And like and willing to take, like, they're not going to like, you know, apologize for their position and their, no. and their stance or anything. And that's Bernie's, that Trump style as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is, you know, it's, you know, here we go. One year we had Trump and here we have the Bernie revolution. It's not a coincidence. There's something about the underlying cultural mush of the nation that is more attuned to this style. Maybe it's the social media. I'm not sure exactly what it is, the explanation is, but it seems like we're fed up with the old style of rhetoric, of tame rhetoric, of, you know, constraint.
Empty promises.
Empty promises, and like it just hasn't got us much. And yeah, I mean, multiple decades of like people who didn't talk like this, and now this is what we've got.
Yeah, I mean, I would. Where do you think that comes from? Because I've obviously it's probably a bunch of things.
Yeah.
The factors. Or the sentiment of the population that you're talking, describing, and like what type of candidates people like are resonating right now in 2020. I think I would point to a few different things. One, I would point to like income inequality, which I think is still at like a real all-time high. I think like even though there's some economic indicators that say like, you know, unemployment's really low, for instance, I think people are underemployed, and most people are like, you know, they have access to goods and luxury goods and stuff, but you know, like, a lot of studies will show you empirically, or at least, you know, social science, to believe the stats what you want, but happiness generally is measured relative to other.
Totally relative.
Right.
So, and living standards are all relative.
Everything's relative, right? So how good you feel about your position in life is often dictated by the position that you find other people around you in. And when you're living in a society where wealth, you know what type of wealth exists within the same society.
Yeah, and I think that's, like, that's...
That causes tension. I think so people are generally, I think, feeling the pinch, even if materially they have better TVs.
Objectively.
Every aspect of their lives is better than it was 50 years ago.
Yeah.
People still aren't satisfied with what they have and are much less satisfied now than they ever have been. Or not ever have been, but certainly in recent history, in the last few decades. I think there's that sentiment.
And I think some of that, just to add on that, is social media too. Like, social media allows you to see
the transparency of the
elite, of the rich.
And also misrepresents how most people are living.
Yeah.
Right? That's another phenomenon associated with social media where
everybody's
only
doing
see everyone's best self.
Yeah.
Right? And so being exposed to that every day.
So you're seeing all like, you're like, and so there's this.
You're like, what's going on in my life? Why am I working this fucking job?
Yeah.
This guy's like posting pictures at the beach.
Yeah.
Like, what? And that, meanwhile, that guy, that's his 3 days he's had off all year.
Yeah.
And you saw that one picture and you're like, this guy's killing it.
Yeah.
And, you know, whatever. So there's that. And then I think there's.
Not to say that the inequality isn't happening, but I do think that the social media intensifies the degree to which it feels personal.
Yeah. That's
and,
exactly
and
right.
And due to which you're willing to tolerate things because of it.
Yeah. And so there's that. I think there's, you know, the other, you look at it from a government perspective, and, you know, I always, in every conversation I talk about politics, I'm always 6 degrees away from this one Princeton paper that was written, like, maybe 15 years ago at this stage, where they just, like, did a huge historical analysis over the last, like, 50 years of every policy decision that's ever made. And they correlated that with polling from labor, polling from the general population, polling from corporate interests, and polling from, I think, like, the wealthy or the elite. And then they tried to correlate what policy outcomes happened based on which group wanted which thing to happen. And they found zero correlation between what the public wanted and what policies were passed. They found intense correlation with corporate interests.
Yeah.
They found some, but muted correlation with labor, with like unions and union interest, and they found a strong correlation with like the wealthy. And the conclusion of the paper is we live in an oligarchy. And if you look at like the outcomes of what government policies that are passed, and like the only time that they said in the article, like the only time the public got an issue passed where they were polling, like, you know, most of the public wanted something done, was when that issue did not conflict with any of the other three groups.
Yeah.
Like, gay rights is a great example.
Yeah.
It didn't hurt any, that didn't hurt corporate interests, that didn't hurt, like, you know, labor, and that didn't hurt the wealthy. So they're like, yeah, fuck it, you guys can have gay rights.
Yeah.
So that's all, to zoom back to where we were talking about, I think there's this sense of, like, the government's not working for me, and whether you're Democrat or Republican, you're not getting Republican things passed that you vote for. You're not getting Democratic things passed what's happening is it's just sort of sitting there taking, taxing you.
So do you think it's like that's built up over time though? Because it's like 50 years, right? So basically what that says is that it's nothing new then. Generations have come and gone.
I forget whether they showed through to what the effect of time was, but I think it's you can intuit that it's gotten worse. Those effects.
Yeah. So it seems. I would say
it's Citizens to me, like all the.
Yeah. Maybe. I'm a little suspect of that because I don't feel like the country was ever run in a with maybe the glaring exception of the FDR era. The New Deal era. Is there any other time in American history where, and obviously it's just get back farther enough back in American history, it stops being relevant in terms of comparisons. I think at least it's hard for me to compare us to the 1850s. Like, what do I know about the politics of then?
Yeah.
So it's really kind of post-war era.
Sure.
So I don't know. I can see that. It's just I don't know if that's. I look at like more things like globalization. I think that's what I would say is like. Seems to me that that's the biggest change over the last two decades.
So why would that derive populism?
Well, I think in terms of the degree to which...
populism I'm using as a stand-in for... Originally, this was candidates like Trump and Bernie seemed to be more when Pete's and that type of candidate...
And even Warren's. Like the Warren versus Bernie stylistic difference, even though on a policy they're probably pretty similar, it seems, like. Just stylistically, people have... been like, she's suspect because she's not so. She is a little. We've talked about it ourselves. We've been like, we don't know if we buy her, her policy positions. Even though she's saying free college and Bernie's saying free college and Bernie's saying Medicare for all and she's saying Medicare for all, she's suspect. Whereas Bernie's like, this guy means it.
And I guess.
Back to what I was saying, is like, I would, I guess.
You say globalization is leading to this in some way.
Globalization being, I can point to globalization as intensifying over time.
Sure.
And we know the impacts of globalization kind of stack in a way, a measurable way.
In that you get displacement
of jobs. And in a way that I can point to tangibly. And I'm not to take anything away from your kind of prescriptive.
I think
the globalization thing in particular leading to the sense that, like, we no longer have control of our government. The global mechanisms of finance... and the elite kind of like ascending to this global level from a narrative standpoint. Okay. We've lost control of our government.
You would tie this to like Bolsonaro or to like Brexit or to like...
Yeah, these like meta narratives of like... Because it's like... You mentioned this to me. It's like we're not the only country seeing tumult. It seems like the world's on fire. And I don't know if that's just me being young and not having seen the world on fire in the past, but like... You're seeing pretty dramatic stuff across the world. Hong Kong with the protests. At one point, it felt like every country in the world was protesting. There was protests in the street in Chile, Hong Kong, in France,
UK.
In the UK. You've got tumult.
Brazil.
India was like this big sleepy stable democracy for generations. It seemed like to me that's just a narrative that
I got.
Put a
pin in India let's go back because I want to talk.
So
about
all these things though, it seems to me like something is intensifying the degree to which the state orders in which people kind of like woke up. Everybody's waking up and looking around and going, wait a second, what's going on? And it's intensifying the populations of these countries. In a way that they're not willing to go on.
Like, and so people are just saying the way things were, I would simplify it as like the way things were and the way status quo is currently
insufficient.
And whether you're on the right or the left, status quo is insufficient for large segments of most countries.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
There are populations in most countries that are completely fine with status quo.
Of course.
Look at the Biden numbers.
Yeah.
But... you know,
just like that percentage has all of a sudden gotten big enough where it's now...
It's now, and in the case of Brexit, in the case of Donald Trump...
Yeah, and it's a feedback loop too, because all of a sudden it's like, if there's a population on the right that grows that is okay with that, that
sends a signal to the pop on the left that it's okay, that we also need to respond with that, right? Yeah, there's definitely some like feedback loop type situations where it intensifies off itself.
Which is honestly very similar to the algorithms that like a Facebook or a YouTube uses, where like you're watching a video on
which
like,
so points into like that other causal effect.
Like,
next thing you know, you like
you're vegan.
You like or like you know you like you pause for a second as you're scrolling through your YouTube feed over. Like a Ben Shapiro video or a TYT video, you pause for a second and it does like the self play for 2 seconds and it picks you up as having paused. It's like it knows that you paused on that video and read the title. And boom, next time you scroll through, you've got three of those videos instead of one in your feed.
Yeah.
And like, and like,
see, Tucker
Carlson
slammed.
So
we're doing that, but the algorithms, I mean, what's funny about this and is the algorithms are just responding to what humans do and then giving us, like, and then rewarding,
and then
building processes that like optimize our innate wired.
And just speeding it up.
Yeah, it's speeding it up.
It's kind of like a dialect. It's almost like a dialect.
It's like the algorithms just picked up on a mathematical pattern.
The spiraling dialectic is just accelerating.
Someone starts saying something extreme. It makes it easier for the next more extreme person to come by, and suddenly they go down this really.
Whereas that used to take years, or they might have never even seen those posts. You know, it used to be letters writing back and forth, or it would have to be magazine articles or something, or publications.
Generations passing ideas down slowly.
And it would just take time, and because there was that gap, like things maybe those feedback loops didn't connect.
Yeah.
And ping, 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 ping. Whereas now it's like nobody misses anything.
Yeah.
Oh, I saw. I mean, I can. The amount of like, you know, some literally egg, you know, Twitter egg, right wing Twitter egg says something, and it gets into a Times article.
Yeah.
You know, right wing Twitter egg says like evil thing. It's like 10 years ago, nobody would have known that this racist pig lived somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, he would have been talking to his friends, and it just would have never been any have never propagated.
Or
and now it propagates
shit,
like
say that shit at a grocery store, and someone beat his ass.
Yeah,
you know? Like that's the thing. It's like and that was the extent of his influence on the world.
And now it's like it propagates, and then it goes into Times. They document it. Then there's the left wing people who see that and they're like, "Oh my god, this is so bad." But then there's the right wing people who go, "Ah," and it. So that's that boiling intensification going on, and
so
that would explain why,
yeah.
you know, the rhetorical styles.
Yeah, so that's what Bernie or Biden, yeah. So that means you want an antagonistic rhetoric.
I think Biden is definitely at odds with this, which is why he, at best, you could be as having stumbled into this position as for second, you know, front runner or borderline front runner.
Yeah, he's just the Ted Cruz of this cycle.
Yeah, he's just
Ted
like, he's
the
last gasp of
the
establishment.
The DNC, yeah.
And whatever.
He's gonna lose to the populace, just like the what happened to the Republicans, where they just kept lining up.
And we'll see. Maybe not. You know.
I'm calling it, man.
You're calling it.
You know, the election's done. We don't even need to vote. Just hand it to Bernie, beat Trump. Let's get the debate started. That's where I'm at right now. I don't need to see Biden.
I mean, Bernie v. Trump, I've said it again. It's like, we've kind of harped on it, but it is just remarkable that at this time of crisis, this boiling sensation that we have, that these are the two political leaders that the American public. Now, it's not, you know, you can't blame the people because we're an oligarchy, like you might have said, or whatever. Like, there's just all these systems that are interfering.
But the
fact of the matter is, whoever is in charge of this, and all the varying degrees to all these various people in influence, this is who we've come up with. Now, you might say the elites pick these people. You might say the corporate interests pick these people. Whoever you want to say picks these people. The fact of the matter is, at our time of preeminent crisis, our great mechanisms for filtering out and picking our leaders to go into gladiatorial combat against each other and to come out and lead the nation forward. We've got Trump, you know, his defects, and Bernie, and like, you know,
a socialist.
And like just straight out of the like 60s, you know, just like not even like a
not even a modern socialist, like a,
and you know, he's got a lot of good qualities, I will say. I've said it, and you know, his commitment to his ideas is
remarkable.
It's remarkable
in this day and age,
and I think he comes from a good place, so I don't doubt his sincerity, but it's just like this guy, like we said, I don't think he's ever read, like, you know, I just don't think he appreciates the complexity of the things he's talking about. But whatever. So that's whatever. We can talk about that later. But it's just remarkable
we'll get to that in the debate.
I'm sure. Yeah, we'll dissect these people ad nauseum. But
It's a, these are the two we've filtered out. It's just...
Yeah, it's like this, the current process that we have, to your point, is like...
Whatever it is.
Whatever it is, it seems to select for, right now, the only it's selecting for the most extreme version of each party.
Yeah.
Because those are the only ones who can get through, can garner enough public support.
Yeah.
I think, and like, you know, you're talking about globalization, and I'm talking about dissatisfaction of people domestically relative to the income levels of the top in society. Whatever it is, I think people are just tired of the same old shit, and they want authenticity. I think authenticity is something they all share as well, and I think we've lived, you know, in a, we live in a time of, like, you know, internet chaos where you don't know what you're fucking, every headline is, like, I don't know, nonsense at some level.
It's so, we're like, we're in a...
Like, it's just a propaganda war from every...
Like, we live in such a spin zone. Like,
yeah,
every
article is a spin zone.
Everybody lives in the fake news realm.
And
everybody
so when you
lives...
find someone that just, like, speaks their truth, even if you don't like, even if you don't agree
with
their truth.
With no shame. With
and they're
just
like, this is who I am. This is what I believe.
And, like, just... And that's what we were saying. They both, that Bernie and Trump have that.
Yeah.
That, like, unabashed...
Bloomberg has it, too, but people just don't like what he has to say.
Yeah. And also, he's just... Yeah.
I mean, there's a million things. He's also one of the elites that maybe, you know, whether it's globalization or income inequality, you look at a billionaire. I mean, Trump's a billionaire, though, so what the fuck am I talking about? Like, they're all, you know, it's a weird time, man. It's a weird time to be an American. It's a weird time, weird era.
And there's other factors. There's environmental factors. So on top of all this chaos, we've got climate change, of course, which, you know, we need to return to as a topic. But we've also got the coronavirus.
Yeah, so that was going to be, I think that's what I think we're hoping to talk about a bit. And I think everyone's talking about it right now, right? People are just buzzing over this.
I'm curious to see if our
future listeners survive or not.
Do you want to give a brief, like, give me like a 5-minute summary. Just catch us up on where did the coronavirus come from?
Okay, so we started hearing news of a flu-like thing happening. I started hearing news on, like, of a flu-like thing happening in China back in December, and it's now, what, March? March 3rd. December, kind of January, you start hearing it, you're like, eh, whatever. And then next thing you know, the city, Wuhan, is, what, a city of probably 5 million?
Yeah.
You know, I easily millions of people. You know how these are these massive interior Chinese cities that are just dwarf?
Yeah, you've never heard the name, but they have,
it
like,
turns
more
out,
people than any U.S. city besides New York.
Yeah, exactly. Is on lockdown, and the thing is spreading out of control. And next thing you know, all of China's in lockdown. They have the draconian authority to basically turn the country off. Which is the plus side of top-down authoritarianism.
Sure, it's a very effective way to run a country.
Yeah, well, it's a very effective at stopping...
I shouldn't say run a country. It's a very effective way to do stuff
certain
at
things.
A global level.
Yeah, very certain things are very good. Like, basically, nobody move. If you move, you're going to, you know, you're going to get disappeared. You can stop the spread of a coin, something really well with that because it's effective. Anyway, so... And then, boom, next thing you know... And, of course, China is, like, the effect of the economy of the world, so... You've got planes flying everywhere out of China. You've got ships flying everywhere in and out of China.
Not to mention the influx of people. Like, I mean, I studied in China when I was in grad school for like a few months, and I'm not special. There's millions of people going
business
to and from.
And also it was happening around the time of the Chinese New Year, which made it worse. There was all these celebrations associated with the Chinese New Year. And so next thing you know, Wuhan's locked down. The next thing you know, there's cases in Beijing. There's cases everywhere. It's spreading like wildfire through China. China is responding rapidly now. There was a whole controversy about the degree to which...
Early on,
the communist government was not able to get ahead of this, but once they got ahead on it, they were on it hard. Shut the country down. But it's too late. Now it's in... You know, then next thing... So then it kind of slowed down. Everybody was like, okay, no big deal. And then all of a sudden, boom, it's in South Korea. It's in Italy. Oh my God, it's in Germany. It's in Brazil, Algeria, Greece, Iran... Oh, now it's spreading from Iran to Iraq and Kuwait, and it's like, and it's in the U.S.
It's a pandemic. I don't know if it's officially classified that, but I think people are calling it like, oh, it's almost like it's a tropical storm versus a hurricane. It's like in the tropical storm level of the pandemic. It hasn't hit like.
Which before. Maybe I wasn't too young to recognize, but it definitely feels like it's bigger than anything that we've seen before in terms of
it
like...
It feels like it's bigger than... Certainly
SARS
bigger than Ebola.
Or swine.
Yeah.
Because Ebola is far more deadly, but it is harder to... It is very... It's less... difficult to spread at, because it kills people so fast.
Yeah, it,
like,
yeah.
People,
it runs too hot.
Yeah.
It burns itself out.
Whereas this is like, it lingers. And it's less deadly, you know? So I think they said it's 3% of people die, which means, and mostly it's like the older people.
But now talk about what 3% means when you have like,
yeah, so
infection
then,
rates. Like,
so I, you know, I read, okay, I meant, you know, maybe it's hyperbolic, but I, epidemiologist, that, that,
yeah,
study disease at Harvard said, he estimates that something like 40 to 70% of the world population will contract corona at some point. Which is like, okay, startling.
Startling numbers.
But as you start to see how this happens, like, you start to read the stories about how this stuff gets transmitted, and maybe we'll go through a couple examples, but it's, see, you can see how quickly this stuff just moves. And I think about it in the city. We live in New York. The subway, someone goes with the corona onto the subway not knowing they have it.
That's it.
Game over. 10 people on the subway have it. Boom. They all go in 10 cars later in the day coming home from work. The speed at which this stuff, exponential growth, is startling.
The odds of someone in New York getting coronavirus, very high.
Well, no, it's
already... I mean, I know it's already happened.
It's here.
It's here. But so I'm just saying, but even before it was here, it's like the odds were incredibly high. The odds that that one person who's got coronavirus rides a New York subway, also very high. And the New York subway is just a death trap for viruses. It's built to transmit viruses.
Yeah.
If you've ever been on a rush hour subway in New York,
You
understand what I'm talking about. It's like those videos you see in like Tokyo or anything,
yeah,
else. Like,
except
you are,
nope,
slammed,
yeah,
on top of people. I am body to body with people on the commute in,
yeah,
the morning. I'm my,
yeah, hundreds of thousands of people.
I've got at least six faces whose hot breath is just hitting me.
Yeah.
My whole way to work.
Yeah.
And that's just the reality for people riding the subway. If one person has the virus, every single person has the virus.
We, you know, so I think yesterday, Monday, I saw the first headline, first for confirmed case in New York City. Today we've got, that was I think Monday or Sunday.
Okay.
A woman who was a nurse was in Iran and flew back from Iran, and she knew she was at risk and self-quarantined herself. And so
that's what people are doing. They're self-quarantining. Which,
but
God,
today, today it's Tuesday. It's only Tuesday. We've got confirmed cases in a high school in the Bronx. We've got another confirmed case of a lawyer or someone like that in Midtown. So one case yesterday. I think we've got multiple cases in New York City city limits today. One, you know, it's like tomorrow. That's only two. That's 2 days. That's 2 days. From the first case to the third and fourth or fifth reported cases. You know, we'll check back in a week. That's, you know, we'll,
yeah,
see, like, in a week. And it's either going to, and maybe we're, maybe I'm buying the hype on this.
It's hard to say. I mean, I'll read this. I read, we already talked about this a little bit before the podcast, and Lauren and I were laughing at it a little bit. But, you know, I read a headline today that was like, Corona, Mike Pence shakes hand with students who shared class with student who's under quarantine. And so that makes it seem like the Vice President of the United States was just exposed to coronavirus. And then I read the story, and the details were, a nurse, similar to the nurse in New York, a nurse was taking care of a patient in a hospital. It was later determined that that patient had coronavirus, so the nurse self-quarantined. Her son went to school, came home, and then he self-quarantined because his mom's self-quarantining. She doesn't have it yet. She's just doing this out of protection to just see. It's even less likely then that her son has it. He was only at school for a short time. So it's even less likely that he transmitted it to his fellow students, who then went on to shake the hand of Mike Pence, which seems very unlikely that like 7 degrees from the patient in the hospital would jump to Mike Pence, but it is possible, and that is how disease spreads.
Well, it's yes, but also we're only looking at Mike Pence. So think about the network
of each person
of all this,
yeah,
and Mike Pence, of which Mike Pence is only one.
Each one of those students that Mike Pence shook hands with has a family
and
a job,
and all, like, you know,
that
kid took a bus to work or to school or something. Boom, boom, boom,
boom.
They
got coffee at the local town, whatever.
You know,
like,
and, you know, and also, and the mom, she went to and from work. You know, and so you look at that web, and the chances that one person there has it.
Her husband's office. You know.
You know,
like,
and
yeah,
so it can go.
That's
and
how
so
the virus spreads, and so even,
and it just takes time, and it's exponential.
And if the death rate stays at 3%, and we're talking,
so yeah,
about,
I did the math, and it's something like, I assumed right. So there's, let's say there's 7 billion people in the world.
Yeah, let's. Is do that, I'm gonna pull out a calculator right now.
7 billion people in the world.
This is pretty dark, but
yeah.
So we got
7 billion people in the world.
Yeah, and we're saying,
let's say
let's say one third, just to be conservative.
Okay, so a third of that is $2.1 billion
times point 0.03. Yeah.
Okay, that's 63 million people from just coronavirus. 63 million people. That's a fifth of the United States just disappearing. That's like the, you know, I mean that's an absolute atrocity. I don't know. It's horrifying if
it's horrifying.
Reaches that level.
Well, so and of course the panic. Well, so I think what's more interesting for us is that we're talking about the, so like, in New York you can't get hand sanitizer anymore. You can't get sanitary wipes. Oh, God forbid you can't get masks.
Oh, you can't get anything.
No, it's all sold out.
Yeah,
and the food is starting to sell out. And what's more interesting, I think, beyond the panic buying, like at Whole Foods, you can't get any frozen food; it's all gone. Is like so in China's stopping. They're actually reporting less cases now. They've stopped the spread, and the total number of cases is counting down. But they've shut down their entire economy, and they've basically said no one go to work, no one move.
The factory of the world just turned off.
And so you have seen these statistics about the number of ships leaving Chinese ports, just catastrophic fall off. Catastrophic fall off. The number of ships.
You're talking like it's like 50%
or something. It's in that area of like the fall in like port traffic. And now in California, right on the coast of LA and San Francisco, where the ships from East Asia are landing with all the goods being produced. Catastrophic falls and then.
Just to put that into context, just like we did with the number of deaths. Think about what that means. If you go to like a Walmart, you're looking at shelves that are 90% made from China. So they're running
razor thin inventories.
So just imagine half the shelves are empty.
Yeah.
Imagine that Walmart is literally half of everything in Walmart is gone in every Walmart
and
in
there's,
the entire
and there's
country.
And there's no resupply coming because
the country. There's no resupply coming for as long as they want to stay turned off, which so far we've got like a month of being turned off. So you can expect in the stores experiencing effects that lasted at least a month.
I think people are kind of expecting it to, like, you know, it's starting to show up now. Like, it's going to start to, it takes a while because you burn through the inventory. There's the supply that was already on the way. All that inventory kind of works through, and all of a sudden it's like, the pump got stopped somewhere along the line. And so once it runs out,
those shelves aren't getting refilled until China turns it back on.
Yeah, it's presumably spreading to, you know, the Vietnams of the world, the Indonesia, the Philippines, India.
All the raw materials that go to all the factories everywhere.
And we'll see what happens. You know, so,
so the
stock market's down.
Stock market's crushed.
You have to imagine that the manufacturing output of the world is falling. That, you know, it seems impossible that global recession's not.
Right. I mean, so
it seems like it's like almost impossible that we wouldn't have like. Conferences around the world are being canceled. Like business travel canceled. Tourism.
Austin, Texas, South by Southwest probably gonna be canceled.
Yeah, tourism canceled. Like
companies are telling people to stay home.
Yeah, like my sister works is a waitress, at a fancy restaurant in Brooklyn. Like, she's budgeting for the fact that she's gonna be making less money over the next month or two because
people aren't coming.
It hasn't really happened yet, but like,
if
we only got our first case yesterday. If it starts, boom, 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 in a week or two, like no one's going out to restaurants.
And that's less spending power.
And
for
months her,
later.
And it's like this is like
reverberating. So you think about 2008 with the housing crisis. That was like a financial crisis at first. It was a crash in the financial sector.
And then
economy.
The credit market seized, and then the real economy
felt the effects. People couldn't sell their homes, and people were getting, their homes were getting foreclosed upon, et cetera. And then we felt the brunt of the recession as jobs started slowing down. And
manufacturing output,
So now this is a complete inverted version. You know, this is not like the financial sector and the stock market.
Great.
I think many people thought very overheated. Probably it was on a historic run.
Yeah, and I mean,
absolutely historic.
I think there was no bubbles. You know, people didn't feel like there was bubbles really in the asset evaluations. Like, I don't think.
I think there was. I think if you looked at like, PE ratios in this recent
it is historic.
It was like pretty overheated.
But what people were not seeing is like there wasn't a source of instability in the economy.
Exactly.
That knows nothing to knock the shop. It was like the housing market wasn't overvalued. It wasn't the oil. It was just like
this was the longest economic expansion on record in U.S. history. Right. So, like,
from... Can I actually pause and ask a question? Because you know so much more about this than me, and I don't have an opportunity to learn about this stuff from you very often, but... when I think, because I'm new to like thinking about finances, the financial space, and like certainly the stock market and its relationship to the real economy, in any meaningful way. But when just evaluating the stock market and the economy dynamics, if you know, talking about this run that we've been on, you're right. It's that like there wasn't anything to worry about necessarily. Maybe people weren't feeling super comfortable in one way or another, but people were buying shit day in, day out. People were living very full and rich lives, even if politically maybe things are unsettled.
Yeah.
People are buying and spending. Jobs are filled.
And gross domestic product was expanding. Even though that's not an imperfect number, the fact of the matter, it still does tell a story of, like,
things. And in that context, companies are being valued far above the material worth of their company and far above what their actual revenues are based on expectations that, like, this type, we can be overconfident in bet on the future of a Tesla, let's say, that's not really producing numbers anywhere close to what its stock's valued at. We're fine betting on the future because I'm going to have a job tomorrow and I'm like buying and I'm comfortable in my life. And so I'm fine like taking a bit more of a gamble on equities, right?
Yeah.
And trying to like bet on the future.
And it's also,
it's like
also
a level of confidence that people were investing.
It's individuals and it's also businesses basically saying like there's growth opportunity here. We're going to take a pile of money and invest in new machines or.
Rather than sit on that cash and worry because it didn't feel like there was anything quite around the corner. So it's like, yeah, everything might be overvalued. But that's because we're all confident that like tomorrow is going to be better than today.
Yeah,
and there's no reason to think it won't be.
It takes a shattering of confidence. Yeah, you know, and no matter what any economist tells you, nobody understands how it's just too complex an organism. It's like the climate in a lot of ways where it's like we can model specific things really well. We know that there is in fact relationships between this and this. Like we can model things very independent components of it, but like. To have a comprehensive understanding of how the exact impact of every lever, nobody knows. And so what you look for is, sources.
It's like data points like inflation that they try to like
keep
within certain ranges.
And, so when
but there's no reason to believe that inflation at any given
because there's micro recessions happening all the time in the sense that a business goes out of business, right? Like some company pops, like WeWork.
Yeah.
Huge valuation popped. So like there's
people lost their jobs.
There's negative impacts on the economy from cascading through from that overvaluation, and then there's like that reset where the valuation gets written down, money's lost. There's a negative impact on the economy cascading out, right?
It's just small.
It's small. It's micro, and that's happening all the time, everywhere.
And companies are starting and exploding too.
Yeah, exactly. So that's all happening, and
all
the recession is that it kind of gets to this like it's like a cascade that gets to like a critical mass where it starts. You know, the negative feedback loops start accelerating, and there's a large scale write down of a resetting of revaluation of assets. And
at the end of the day,
across the economy, and everybody kind of cuts their losses, reset, and then you start growing again.
And at the end of the day, it's because the economy at the end of the day is just people and people trading and stuff. And so,
it's expectations games.
And recession is really people saying, I don't want to, engage anymore, and I want to just protect what I have. And worry about losses, losing my material
possessions. I would say a recession is the symptom of that happening across a widespread.
Yeah, recession is a description
of an aggregate result of
300 million individuals in the case.
And if some critical mass of them start making kind of similar decisions about their perspective.
Whether that's decisions within their company.
And they all have different motivations. You know, it could be all they're all coming from different things. But if it gets big enough, it can cause a recession. And so,
it's not, at the end of the day, isn't it simple enough? Can you reduce the economy down to, let me say it like this.
No.
Is the economy some emergent property like consciousness is with billions of brain cells? Or can you reduce the economy down into saying actually, if you somehow could add up 300 million people's, if you could add up all of their quote confidence,
yeah,
right, at any given time and quantify that, add all that together, that's the economy. And so if there's a recession, really what that's saying, yeah, you can look at it as like companies are suddenly like, you know.
No, I don't think about that. I think confidence is more of just one narrow descriptor of, or one narrow aspect of the economy.
I guess I'm just saying, can you view recessions and
as crises of confidence?
At the individual level, can you just, is it as simple as just saying like, it's a recession is just a word that describes 300 million people and all their economic activity suddenly moving from, I believe in the future, to I'm going to protect what I have now and stop trying to grow as much. And so you get what that results in is, of course, a contraction of businesses, a lowering of home values and everything. But it's really as simple as just like, it's not really, you can never measure that within a population, but that's really, or is it something like, you know what I'm getting at with the consciousness analogy?
Yeah,
you could add up individual brain cells, but it's not going to tell you what Trevor is.
Yeah.
Right?
No.
Trevor is like a higher level emergent property of neurons.
I tend to view it more as that, whereas confidence is only, because there is, yeah.
It's fascinating if that's the case, just on a metaphysical level. But
That's how I think. I mean, I think the economy is like this, like, incredibly, I mean, and this informs my kind of, my inherent, like, libertarian. It's like,
the way you talk about, like, the market is as if it's this, like, real thing, and it's not just the summation of individual actions.
Yeah, well,
it's
not the market per se. It's like this, like, but yeah,
economy,
it's this emergent.
Not the market, but the economy.
But yeah, same thing. Terms. It's like an emergent property that, like, is like
of the individual actions.
But it's just like it's an extension of the consciousness of all these combined. You know, it's like very
it's a fist is stronger than five individual fingers, that type of thing.
It's very much like a political ideas, I guess, right? Like that, like in the same way that it can't be like dissected scientifically.
This is what Gernot Escherbach, that book,
yeah,
is about. It's
okay.
Like thinking about life in different systems in this way, mental systems and economics and stuff, and any of these systems, and trying to look at it from a reductionist point of view.
Yeah.
Looking at any given system, let's take what we're doing with the economy, looking at it from a reductionist perspective, which is it's the sum of parts.
Yeah.
It's the sum of individuals acting in individual
and
ways.
And we can theoretically, even if we can't do it, we could...
You can
add it all up.
If you could, there's a theoretical place where you could add up all those actions, and that could describe the economy perfectly. Or you can view it, quote, holistically,
yeah,
which is the people don't matter at all.
Yeah.
Right? They give you no information. It's much more useful to think about the economy in terms of, like, I don't know, the NASDAQ, or to think about the economy in terms of, like the interest rate or inflation.
Yeah. Or gross capital flows and stuff like that.
Right, exactly. So on these aggregate, on this big aggregate.
Yeah, like, I'm not as familiar with that distinction, those distinctions, but I do think.
Reductionist versus a holistic point of view.
It is to me, simply, like you said, there is this reductionist aspect where it is just individual actions. It has to be.
Because we're all people, right?
Yeah.
It's just the way that, like,
yes,
you are all cells.
Yeah. Yes, there is, like, algorithms participating today, like,
yeah,
you know, high-frequency trading algorithms, but, like, someone's, like, turning that on and off, right?
Right.
Like, people are saying, let's allocate money to this trading algorithm, right? So, like, it's the aggregate of lots of individual, but there's something about the mixing of, you know, our consciousnesses that make it so complex, that make it so you can't really...
Thinking about it on that level is as useful as me thinking of you as a collection of cells.
Yeah.
And addressing each of your skin cells individually.
Yeah, when you know that at the end of the day...
It's easier to just talk to Psy.
You have to do,
you know,
this kind
mean?
Of, like,
yeah,
abstract synthesis that you know is incomplete, but is the only way to, like, actively engage with it.
So getting back to
sorry, that was a huge aside, but that's... So
getting back to Corona...
Yeah, Corona and the impact on the economy.
To me, it seems...
Because we're talking about meaningful recession.
Yeah, and a physical, like, it's like a shock to the, you know, the supply side.
Supply side shock.
Yeah, like basically all this shit shut down.
Running out of goods. And so I was reading something.
And then,
can you elaborate?
I guess actually really what it is it's actually probably not a supply side shock. I guess most people would say it's a demand shock.
It's both. I think people are saying it's both.
Yeah, so basically, like, everyone stopped buying things, right?
Yeah.
And
there's not enough stuff to buy.
And there's no,
it's literally both. And so my understanding is that, like, most monetary policy or fiscal policy that a government can do can really influence the demand side.
Stimulus package. You know,
is that,
like,
true?
Yeah, it's like, let's spend money, or let's free up the flow of money. That's the best tool, like, a central bank has, right?
Yeah.
Or a federal government has. Supply side stimulus is typically, or theoretically, thought of as, like, let's make it easier to produce stuff on average, which is typically like structural reform. Let's like free up, let's deregulate the economy so that shit can get produced quicker and faster and more efficiently.
Does it have to be deregulation, or is it the same as like liberalizing and driving manufacturing?
So that's why supply side stuff gets weird, because it's demand side is like, let's spend more money, let's buy more shit, print money. Yeah. Demand side shock, like print money, everybody buys more shit. That's going to make things keep going.
And how does lowering interest rates affect demand side?
So lowering interest rate, lowering or increasing interest rates changes the, investment, basically the flows of investment flow, investment flows is what I would say. So wherever, when interest rates are higher, it's less conducive to borrow, right?
Of course.
Right.
Yeah.
And vice versa. So, typically what you see is, lower interest rates are kind of like thought of as like a stimulus.
Yeah.
Because as when interest rates are lower, companies can borrow more, people can take out homes, they buy homes, homes get built, companies get founded, so on and so forth. Because
fine.
People, and so as you raise interest rates though, and that kind of slows that down to a certain degree. Now, why would you ever raise interest rates then? Well, because if interest rates get too, there's value in having the ability to lower interest rates.
That's where that, but there's got to be a value to just having high interest rates. Wouldn't the value be that it makes it harder to borrow money, which means only stable businesses can thrive?
Well, exactly. And you can overheat the economy. I mean, that's a weird way to describe it. Yeah. You want to make sure that the economy doesn't get too wild. And
it's not just wild, it's that like you don't want it to be too easy to start a business that's not actually sustainable unless you're constantly borrowing money.
Yeah.
So you want healthy businesses.
I think that's a good way
to put it. So it's like you want forest fires.
You want some like challenge to kind of filter.
It's like you either have a recession that clears out bad businesses, or you have high interest rates, so it's harder to borrow money.
And it kind
of
filters it out on the market.
And that sort of does the same sort of recession type effect on a limited scale.
Yeah.
What's hysterical to me, so that makes sense, and I appreciate that. But so now let's tie that to the coronavirus, because the Fed lowered interest rates today.
Yeah.
By like 0.5% or something. They normally do that at periodic meetings, right? Make a decision what to do with them.
Yeah.
And in this case, they didn't wait till their regularly scheduled meeting, they just came out and said, we're going to lower interest rates. Now, it's presumably to stimulate the demand side of our economy.
Yeah, I think the G7 finance ministers are gathering and trying to figure out what to do.
Right. Now, I will say, as a very ignorant person on these subjects,
yeah,
that seems absolutely ridiculous to me. That the Fed coming out, and I noticed the stock market still fell 2%, like most of the major indices fell 2% today. Like,
yeah.
It was a bloodbath today, even after the Fed did this. And that makes sense to me, because the facts you were just outlining of, yeah, of course, we can stimulate demand side by, we're going to marginally decrease the central bank interest rate by 0.5%, and the effects are on all the other financial institutions, they're going to be able to now lend money a little more easily to businesses.
Yeah.
And so we're going to therefore see businesses take on loans and invest in themselves and grow.
Yeah.
And that's going to, they're going to pay people more.
Yeah.
And those people are then going to buy stuff.
Yeah.
And that's going to save us from the coronavirus.
Yeah.
That's going to save us from the economic reality that is going to be manifested by the coronavirus.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? The idea that you could just lower interest rates by 0.5% right now, today, and that's going to help the economy in any meaningful sense. People are not staying home because they're not satisfied with the available interest rate for starting a business right now.
Well, that's
people are staying home because they're afraid of dying.
Well, no, I think
like
I totally agree with that. It's delusional.
Delusional to think.
I think the mechanism there is exists. I do think that
those relationships
do exist. It's just like a question of scale and
timing, dude. Like
it also goes to that point that we've made with Russ Roberts, who's like, this overconfidence in like economics as a science, when it's like, you gotta look around, bro.
Yeah,
it's
why not 0.6%?
Yeah. Yeah.
Why is it 0.6% coronavirus adjustment?
Yeah. Doing what they can. I mean, they're doing they're doing what they can, and they're just like saying, okay, well, we got to do something, and this will help. But, it's not going to be enough.
I mean,
what what it will help is that, you know, should this like peter out, you know, let's just say like our hype is oversold, which it might be, honestly, you know, in both in terms of the scale of the spread and the deaths associated with the spread, but also like the economic impact. Well, it might be, what if this kind of just peters out over the next month and, you know, come June, we've forgotten about the coronavirus. You know, the economy is still going to be, those cascading impacts are still going to be like settling out. And that 0.5%, or, you know, maybe they do a second rate decrease.
Well, that's what I was going to say.
It will make an impact. Like, it does make an impact.
Let me say, though, but your first point was the reason you raise interest rates is so you can lower them when you need to lower them, which is a hilarious point that I've heard, not just you make. I've seen a lot of people say that about raising interest rates. Again, why do it now? Because, again, doing it right now means you have less to do later when that moment happens, when the coronavirus is over.
And
doing it now is not going to spur any new investment, is not going to spur anyone taking on debt to grow their business. Businesses from JP Morgan to mom and pop hardware store are bracing for the real spending, decrease in spending they're going to see from consumers, from people not wanting to leave their homes, and they're grappling with a huge increase in their wholesale prices from all the stuff that they buy from China.
Yeah,
because we're a globalized economy. It's not just China. All the countries that are exposed to this are shutting down. And the
there's a big theory that it's not the actual absolute rates that matter. It's the directional. It's like as we said earlier, it's all relative. The only thing that matters about rate moving by central banks is the signaling impact that it has to the economy at certain moments.
And I just don't think you're signaling.
So this is like a wasted signal, because it's a signal in a fucking you're like putting your light out and it's a fucking gargantuan winter blizzard and like save that for when it stops snowing and people are looking to find civilization.
Exactly, dude. That's a perfect analogy. Yeah. You're wandering in the woods in the winter and you've got a dinky flashlight with an hour
and you're
of battery
like,
and you're going to burn 5 minutes when the storm starts?
Yeah.
You're going to save that shit to find survivors.
I think that's exactly right. But
I think you mentioned
globalization. I think the other really interesting aspect about this is the degree to which all this anti-globalization feeling that's welled up over the last decade. And this just kind of feels like a death blow
to globalization.
Not that I ever expect globalization to cease, but like to the political rhetoric around and people's understanding of like the consequences of globalization, here's this other thing that nobody had really taken seriously, that the interconnected supply chains might seize up.
Yeah.
And then what happens? What happens when we want surgical masks and we can't get them because they're all made in China?
Yeah.
Like, wait a second. I guess we do need to make surgical masks in this country. Yeah. Right? Like, maybe we don't, but like,
that's
realization that, oh my God, there's this other consequence to globalization of like, we can't get our shit.
Yeah.
There's going to be empty shelves. And it's not that they just took our jobs,
and
but
Americans haven't had to face that really since World War II.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It feels like this like big wake up moment when we're all like, wait a minute, this house of cards relies on nothing going wrong. And like this perfectly synchronized globalized social supply chains that are like amazing miracles of logistics that like get all these goods everywhere all the time. There's never anything.
And all it takes is one person in that chain of information, or that chain of supply, to be like, you know what, I'm folding up shop.
Yeah, and so I think that's the more long term thing is like, for me is interesting, is like, to what degree does this impact the conversation about global supply chains and also it's happening, and it's already happening right now, where like the US and China are kind of like, a lot of American supply chains are moving out of China because of the trade tension and this realization, whatever. So that was already kind of this, they call it the decoupling between the Chinese and American economies, which if you think that trade reduces the risk of war, is a little scary.
Which I tend to subscribe to that.
I tend to think it's true. Yeah, if we're trading, then there's risks to war. Whereas if we were completely decoupled, then like, why not bomb the shit out of each other?
Yeah.
But that's already happening because of the last couple of years of like politics. And to what degree does this further that specific relationship? Maybe we still do globalized supply chains through the Americas, but like, accelerating the decoupling of the United States and America and the Chinese economy.
Yeah, the specific example of China is interesting, and the general example of you know, how does the American populace and the American political
and every everywhere, you know, I'm sure this is happening not just to us, but to, like, you know, the Germans and
So how do countries like, how do they respond? How do the people, especially in democratic places where people have more of a say?
And I think and how do they respond? And also the fact that China was like, okay, to save our country, we need to shut down the country. So we're gonna do that. Like, I don't care if you guys need our shit right now. Like, we gotta do what we need to do. Which is, like, I don't blame them necessarily for, like, taking that stance. But the realization that, like, yo, like, if China wants to, they can. It's not like a, like, we could never have that kind of draconian response here. Like, it just would never happen. Like, we couldn't just tell all the factories to stop producing. It's not an option. Yeah, like, you can't. It's like against the law.
Yeah.
China can do that. They just say, no one do anything. Nobody move, and nobody moves.
That's a really good point.
I think people are going, wait a second, like, they can do that whenever they want. So whether it's the coronavirus or whether it's a trade war, whether it's, like, political conflict, like, we can't rely on them to be, like, a steady-as-you-go partner. So that's another aspect of, like, the global political economy that I think is you know, that's not the first impact, but it's that trickling impact that, you know, shows up 3, 4, 5 years down the road, I think.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be, I mean, this is just like, yeah, we haven't, I don't know if the eras that preceded ours were as chaotic or crazy. It seems like, from what I read of the 60s, it sounds like a pretty crazy time to be in America.
I think the 60s were I think there was lots of times in which areas of the world were localized way more crazy, without a doubt.
Yeah, 100%.
So even in America, like, locally in America, like, it was way more intense, right?
Yeah.
For sure, but in the 60s.
It seems like we're in a global, like, crisis.
The degree to which...
On multiple fronts.
Yeah, which the whole world interconnected, and what's so amazing about it is that it's all so, like, interconnected that we're kind of seized up together. Like, you can't just operate independently anymore, and so a crisis is everywhere, or create crises for everybody else. Like, Turkey's crisis in Syria, where they're now fighting the Syrian Arab army of Assad in Idlib province in northern Syria, is caused them to open up their borders with Greece and Bulgaria because they want to pressure Europe into supporting them in Syria, which is now creating a crisis, an increased, you know, migrant crisis in the euro, which can only mean political, you know, processes in the European countries are going to react to the flow of migrants, which is only going to impact negotiations with Brexit, which is only going to impact, you know, it's like the degree to which these things just cascade these days is startling.
And it was, and I think it's probably fair to say, and I'm not an expert on these subjects, but, like, it's probably fair to say that at other times in history, in previous eras, that it simply wasn't feasible or possible, or it was honestly laughable to think that you could have a global crisis in any meaningful sense, like something
at this pace, right?
I mean,
the chain of things I just described to you happened over the last, like, 3 days.
Yeah,
you know, the 3 days. The crisis of World War I, that took, like, months to unfold.
Right.
It took months, you know, for that whole thing to unfold.
You're right. No, that's really what it is. Because I was just thinking, like, I always go Genghis Khan when I think about world events in history. And, like, that dude formed an empire, and he did it quickly. I think he did
by
it, like,
historical
decades.
Standards,
Yeah, like, within a decade.
Startlingly,
he had a monster empire. Do you think about the ripple effects of, you know, he takes out Baghdad, the ripple effects to, like, political Islam in the region,
and
how that impacts,
and,
like,
everything, butterfly effect,
or, you know, how he didn't go all the way to, like, France, he just stopped before, and, like, how that could have changed history, whatever. So those were huge impacts, but, like you're saying, the time scale of the Genghis Khan impacts was really on the order of years and generations to feel a change. Like, if you're a French peasant.
Yeah.
Or
like, even a French nobleman or someone who's, like, watching this happen, like, you're only reacting. You're the same. Humans are the same as,
like,
they were back then, right? We're still operating, like, at the same speed. Like, our development biological timelines are the same.
Yeah.
And our ability to process things are pretty much the same, I think.
So if you're. Yeah.
So, like, that was the crisis of the era that
It was. And like, the generations dealt with. When Genghis Khan showed up, you know, you're 25 by the time there's this Mongol Empire to the east that you're maybe hearing about, in the market, maybe from someone who maybe saw something or heard something. There's no written reports.
Another decade before they even reached like the Ural Mountains, another decade before, okay, now they're at your front step. So 40 years in the making.
And let's say then he doesn't go there. He doesn't ultimately hit France. So like, do you feel, if you're a baker, you're a French baker in Paris or whatever, it was Paris back then, you know, like, do you feel any impact from Genghis Khan throughout your entire life? No.
Probably not.
Probably
and
not.
If you do, you have years to respond and acclimate.
Years to respond. And what if you're an Aztec at that time?
Yeah.
Do you feel any impact
from
Genghis
absolutely
Khan? Not a chance.
Whereas today, it's like, this shit is happening, and before you can even react, there's a new one. There's a new crisis, and it's a new crisis.
I mean, climate change is happening on that time scale, but it is happening to all of us, so we are all feeling it.
Yeah,
But then you look at coronavirus and the tanking of the economy and of the stock
market. We'll see. The economy hasn't tanked yet. We don't have the statistics to say that the economy has tanked yet,
well,
even though we are.
We know that we're running out of
speculating
crazy
wildly.
If you want to talk economy and the lived experience, you go to any store in New York. Right,
I mean, it's
now,
startling to go to a grocery store in New York and there's no food in there. Frozen section. It's like
there's no hand sanitizer. There's no masks.
You can't get. I bought ibuprofen. I was like, I was concerned that you might not be able to get ibuprofen.
Pretty spoiled millennial perspective. Again, if you look at the full history of humanity.
Yeah, but it's all relative. And
what other people have lived through. It's like, yeah, we're like, oh, I can't get my ibuprofen.
Yeah, it's like, dude, I couldn't order
drugs.
Yeah,
that's
like I couldn't get it ordered through my front step with my app. Like,
yeah.
No, but. Yeah, it could get ugly here. It's like, you know, we'll see.
In a time, I mean, thankfully modernity has preserved us from like most of the plagues of humanity, whether it's like famine or, I mean, not everywhere in the world, but at least
I know,
the
it's
States
like,
in 2020. This is the first time where it's like,
the world is just not responding to, like, not behaving.
Yeah, the world, well, yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like I'm giving my lived experience like a 3-star review now.
Yeah.
Like, what do you mean? This grocery store doesn't have the towels I want.
Yeah.
Or the Clorox bleach I need. It's crazy. So we'll see. We'll see what the impact is. I think, you know, well, next time we do this, I don't know, there might be some delay between the taping and the next one.
Because of some significant programming adjustments.
Yeah, we should only do programming notes at the top, but I guess we'll just... You know, I'll do it at the...
We'll be doing these remotely from now on.
Yeah. So I'm going to Texas. Sai's staying in New York for the short term. We'll see where he is going forward. But the... you know, we're going to do it remote. I mean, like, I think we're going to try Skype. It should improve the audio quality. You know, I've gotten some feedback from my brother that he refuses to listen past an hour. So we're at an hour 22 right now. So I can only assume he won't hear me. Give him a shout out right now.
Yeah.
He did tell us to improve branding, to tighten up our structure, and improve our audio quality, and that like two mics and syncing up two mics might help with that. So, well, at least hopefully accomplish the latter goal. But
and it's a problem because we have some tension here between our stated beliefs, and it almost feels like doing those sorts of things to the podcast is... It's very cog-like behavior. We are responding to the feedback of the machine and complying.
And complying. And
in order to, like, you know, which, you know, whatever, I guess that's life. But
I mean, we've only advertised ourselves as reluctant cogs, not like defiant cogs.
Yeah, that's
know?
True.
So
yeah.
Eventually we will capitulate.
It's like I was saying yesterday, there's, you know, if you're raging against your machine over here, your rage is only part of is only your role as a larger cog in a larger machine. You know, you can't escape your status as a cog. There's always a bigger machine.
It's turtles all the way down.
Yeah, it's turtles all the way down, machines all the way up. All right. We got an outro track. Trev?
Yeah.
Just throw it on
there. Just for the, you know, the sake of poetry, I got one.
All right. Until next week, two reluctant cogs. Out.